Thanks, buddy. Thank you. That was an awesome introduction. Thank you, Gino. Welcome. Thank you guys all for coming. Very psyched to be in Hong Kong, which has the sickest, craziest skyline I've ever seen in my entire life. I don't know how you guys get any work done. If I lived here, I would just sit and stare out the window all day. Actually, that's what I do at home, too. I just thought I'd say a few words of context before we begin our show. Last year, I published a book called The Head Trip. It's sort of an adventure story through the world of consciousness research. My goal, as I set out to write this book, was to first classify and then experience and finally describe all the most elemental ways.
And to go about that, I became a guinea pig for all kinds of experimentation.
It was a bit of an ambitious goal. And to go about that, I became a guinea pig for all kinds of experimentation. So I spent nights in sleep laboratories. I was hypnotized. I went to meditation retreats, did lucid dreaming workshops, neurofeedback trials. I did weird experiments in my cabin up north. Which sounds really weird, I realize, when I say that. I all kinds of life I created in that laboratory. So I also spoke, on that journey, I spoke to neurobiologists, I spoke to psychologists, but also to historians, to anthropologists, to meditators, to anyone I thought that could give me a fresh perspective on what it really is like to be aware over 24 hours. So the book has quite a bit of neurobiology, but the real focus is the phenomenology, which is what it feels like to be aware. Like, what is it really like? What is it really like to fall asleep, to walk around in a dream, to be alert, or to be in a trance? Like, we think we know, but I thought I just wanted to kind of zoom in the camera. So that's what this next 45 minutes is all about. Although there's a little bit of science, for the most part, it's a work of the imagination, an attempt to dramatize that feeling of being aware at different times of day and night, and to show why they matter, because I think these perspectives, they matter an enormous amount, as you'll see. So my hope is by the end, you'll have both an expanded view of yourself, but also the realities you so carelessly spend time in. So, I think we're gonna kick it off. So if you're ready. Oh yeah, I'm also gonna be walking around with this, because I'm controlling the entire thing by DVD. So, and then you'll have my, I like to usually talk with my hands, you know, I like to kind of, but I got this thing here and this thing here, so it's going to be interesting to see what happens with that situation. All right. So here's the territory we're going to cover. Admittedly, it's a bit, well, it's a bit spare. Awake, then asleep. And that's all most of us notice on our own diurnal head trips. We move through the world too often on automatic, like robots, too busy, too distracted, too exhausted to notice the real texture of our shifting awareness. But what if there's more to it than this? Here's the real map. I call it the wheel of consciousness. The wheel describes 12 naturally occurring states of consciousness that, with one or two important exceptions, most of us pass through at one time or another over the course of our waking, sleeping, and dreaming lives. It turns on a biological clock, a 24-hour rhythm that depends on sunlight to stay on track. So we're going to start here, and we're going to work our way around. I do have to say something quickly about the brain before we get started. At every moment, and the brain's about to pop in here. By the way, I'm trying to sync to these visuals, so it's going to be entertaining to see how well I do that. At every moment, massive numbers of neurons build up and then release little electrical charges. When these neurons fire in unison, it's an indication they're part of a single process or conversation. Although at any one time, there are many different local conversations happening in the brain, there's also a dominant, often a dominant, global conversation, which can be used to identify the big shifts in consciousness that happen as we move around the wheel. The legend at the bottom, as well as the undulating brainwave line in the background, both of these refer to the speed at which that dominant global conversation is happening in a particular state. So purple-blue is slow, red-orange is sort of medium, and yellow-white is fast. The faster the conversation, the more energy in the system, the higher our state of arousal. That said, that would actually make a neurobiologist cringe because it's an extremely gross characterization. There's a lot more going on in the brain at any one time. And this, thankfully, is all the neurobiology you need to know. Let's really begin our trip. I haven't made it all the way around the wheel. Hurry up, wheel. This last one is pure consciousness. That's pretty cool. You'll never see that brain again. It's called the sensory gateway, and it marks the primary dividing line of consciousness. On one side of the gate, we move through a world dominated by sensory input. We call this waking. On the other side, we move through a world dominated by past experience. We call this dreaming. You might say that in waking, our minds are constrained by the real world. But on the other side, the sleeping and dreaming side, sensory input is removed and the mind is set free. It's the beginning of sleep, and the brain is slowly gearing down. Thoughts aren't as zippy. The body's internal temperature begins to drop. Welcome to the hypnagogic state. You've been here before. In fact, you were here last night when you slipped into bed and sunk deliciously into the mattress. Perhaps as you drifted off, you heard sounds. Come on, baby. I know they're there. Slammed doors, disconnected voices, weirdly amplified and distorted. Are they real, these sounds? It's hard to be sure. They could be the final dispatches from waking or first contact with the dream. So what happens to the mind as we fall asleep? Picture a train track. Actually, you don't have to picture it because there's one right there. Our one-track mind. Ordinarily in waking, although our thoughts do skip around a bit, for the most part they move in a fairly straight ahead, linear, progressive fashion. As we fall asleep, this changes. Our thoughts veer onto new tracks. They get more associative, elliptical, bizarre. We think strange things like the weight-bearing load of sweater lint or how to nail melted cheese to the wall. At least that's the kind of thing I think about. Soon, unexpected images begin to rise out of the mist. Distant scenes, half-remembered faces, 100 different tracks waiting to be explored. But I'd like to stop at a single image and take a closer look. Here. At first, these sleep onset images are oddly static, like blurry photographs or snapshots. They pass us by one until by some mysterious process, a single image comes to rest in the mind's eye, like this one. And then something wonderful happens. We're no longer just thinking about some scene. We're inside it. Did you see it? Look very closely. The very beginning of a dream. But we're not there yet. About an hour into sleep, in response to a signal from the brainstem, all hypnagogic imagery gets submerged in a long, slow electrical swell over the whole of the cortex. The tide is about to come in. It's called the slow wave, and it's the deepest stage of sleep. We descend into the slow wave for a total of about 40 minutes every night, mostly in the first half of sleep. Or rather, the slow wave descends into us. That's from The Big Blue. That's a good scene. In some ways, it is the most mysterious stop on our trip, because in slow wave sleep, our ability to form short-term memories is completely disengaged. So whatever we experience in that dark abyss, we leave there. The question is, where are we going? What's it like down there? There are reports of a special kind of awareness. The scientists and the mystics each have a part of the story. Sleep scientists say it's a time of low-level cognition, just the gentle drift of mental flotsam, swimming through our minds and interrupting our peace. That little dude's supposed to represent our thoughts over there. The Buddhist and Hindu meditators, however, who've actually trained their minds to enter the slow wave and take a look around, an astonishing claim, they have a deeper story. They report the slow wave is a place of intense bliss, in which we are paradoxically the most aware. What do they mean? Close your eyes. Close your eyes. Can you feel it? Even now, this bliss seeping up from the deepest part of the mind. Perhaps this is the proto-emotion, the deepest feeling state, a force of mental and physical rejuvenation present in all things and in all beings. Can open your eyes now. There's a famous Latin inscription over the alchemist's doorway. It reads, dormiens vigila, while sleeping, watch. It tells us we may have things to learn even here. But the trip must go on. It's time to move back up to one of my favorite stations. It's called the Watch. Although it's the very middle of the night, this brain is actually awake. Maybe it's happened to you. Few people realize that, like deep sea divers, coming up for air, most of us surface into wakefulness a half a dozen times a night. Usually these wake-ups are so short, we forget they ever happened. But sometimes they're longer. In fact, there's intriguing scientific and historical evidence to suggest that humans once slept in two segments instead of one. We slept once in the late evening and again in the early morning, and in between for a few protected hours, we breached the surface of sleep into an altered state of consciousness called the Watch. The Watch is still in us. It's there every time we wake in the night and stare up at the ceiling or out at the dark sky. Some call it insomnia. But it's an incomplete description. These periods of wakefulness are more usefully seen not as misfortunes, but rather as opportunities. What's it really like to be awake in the night? It can be peaceful. High levels of prolactin, which is a hormone associated with roosting chickens and lactating mothers, it circulates in the brain. That was the brain. Whoosh, did you see that? That was the brain. And it induces a kind of meditative calm. It's an ideal time for contemplation, for prayer. In the Watch, we swim along the surface of sleep, bobbing back and forth between waking and dreaming. Waking thought seeps down into the dream. Dream images bubble up into waking. It's a rare chance to float between worlds. And if we pay attention to the dream images, to reconnect with an oceanic source of myth and fantasy, that is often forsaken in the modern world. Or you can reconnect with Bill Murray, who appears a lot in this thing. There's a whole other class of in-between states known to sleep scientists. They're called the parasomnias, and they do very strange things to the brain. This is a Modest Mouse song, by the way. Lots of good music in this. Perhaps the most well-known parasomnia is sleepwalking. At such times, though our bodies are active, our minds are not. In fact, we're in deep, slow-wave sleep. It's the ultimate mind-body split. While our heads are off in space, our bodies wake and make a break for it. At such times, we're witness to the body's secret life, its undiluted physical instincts and appetites. There are reports of sleepwalkers having sex with strangers in front of their homes. That's a true story, happened in Australia. Other sleepwalkers devour grotesque amounts of food. Their partners find them with their heads in the fridge, faces smeared with raw meat. It gets more sinister. During so-called night terrors, men, women, and children all wake screaming from slow-wave sleep, their minds blank, their bodies seized with unspeakable terror. Others have been assaulted by sleepwalkers, even murdered. Their assailants cannot be reasoned with. There's no mind present to hear your pleas. This is one of Francisco Goya's most famous paintings. A man sleeps at his desk while all around stir the creatures of the night. The text below says, "El sueño de la razón produce monstruos." The sleep of reason brings forth monsters. It's a reminder that without rationality to keep us in check, the animal body can rise and move upon the land, a primal force unencumbered by morality and culture. Parasomnias are a disquieting reminder of civilization's thinness, easily shrugged off in the middle of the night. But we've been asleep for a while now, and yet to encounter a single immersive dream. That's about to change. In response to a signal from the brainstem, the neurotransmitter acetylcholine is released back into the brain, breaking up the delta swells of slow-wave sleep. The brain is suddenly as aroused as it is in waking. The eyes begin to twitch. Rapid eye movement sleep has begun. This is where it gets fun. We're at the edge of the dream now, the generative margins, a kind of neurological kaleidoscope of source material that roils around in the subconscious, flickering and coalescing. All these thoughts and images and feelings and sounds and sensations, it can seem like the very definition of random chaos. That was the cue to the song. But it's not. Dream precepts have their own logic, an underlying rhythm that orders much of the activity. In fact, you might see that dreaming is a kind of dance, and not just any dance, a mambo. A snappy neurological shimmy, where surprising images tap to the beat of the brainstem's electrical snare drum. Dreams contain unlikely dance partners. One key to these unusual pairings is emotions. Emotions are dream music. They control the tone of the dream and provoke related associations and memories. So to use a, oh, hold up, just a few more images. I dream of her all the time. She makes me pasta. So emotions are the music of dreams. To use a very cliched example, if the dominant emotion is sadness, then the setting might be a rainy day, a lost friend, and some kind of weird black thing, which I forget where I got that thing. This is a sad dream. On the other hand, if anxiety is playing on the emotional jukebox, Then the scene might be a memory of being unprepared for a school exam, crossed with your paralyzing fear of small dogs and a psychopathic smurf. As for happy dreams, these will obviously feature Patrick Swayze. Your favorite Disney character in childhood visits to Coney Island. Patrick Swayze, by the way, is in every single happy dream. You read it here first, you heard it here first, I'll be publishing these findings in Nature. The Patrick Swayze effect. So hold on, oh, I forgot my thing. Okay, as much as I would like to just sit here and dance with you for the remainder of this dream, I feel I must point out there's something conspicuous missing from all these fragmented characters and scenarios that I've just described. That would be you. But the question is it a you you recognize? Welcome to your real dream. Watch how you act, because it's a disgrace, a comedy sketch. We're often on the move in dreams, racing around trying to get somewhere, get something done. There's a vaudevillian absurdity to the situations we find ourselves in. We're constantly being interrupted and frustrated and persecuted, or we're trying to get away from a threat, running as fast as we can without seeming to get anywhere. One thing seems clear, most of the time, no matter how absurd the situation we find ourselves in, we don't question our dreams. We're just witless actors in a production we can't control, submitting to the director's every whim. In fact, we are in the grip of what some psychologists call the moment-by-moment mind, and are thus unable to question what the dream world forces down our throats. Perfect timing. But occasionally, usually early in the morning, something magical can happen. Although brain activity stays in REM, our mental activity shifts dramatically. I'll start with a question. Have you ever been dreaming and somehow noticed you're dreaming? Has that ever happened to anyone here? Maybe a show of hands? It often happens to people right before they wake up. They get a sudden sort of self-consciousness of their situation. What few people realize is this little flicker of insight can actually be sustained in the dream itself without waking up. It's part of a profound continuum of dream awareness. At one extreme is normal dreaming, where we run around like Charlie Chaplin on automatic. At the other extreme, past that first flicker of insight is a state of clarity and self-possession, a state of mindfulness that's extraordinary. It's called lucid dreaming. This is a scene from the online virtual world Second Life. I'm sure you've heard of it, an entire world filled with people and landscapes and buildings, not unlike dreaming. You can walk around, have adventures, have conversations, and yet we'd never mistake it for real life. That's because no matter how good the graphics, we're not in the scene. We're watching it. But what if you could actually beam down into this virtual world with all of your waking faculties intact, like a real-life character from Tron? For me, in the dream, it starts with a feeling that something isn't right. I fixate on my hands. The lines shift, they look swollen and unstable. I look up at the world, and this realization hits me. I'm in a dream. And just like that, everything changes. It's like I've noticed the fact of dreaming for the first time. People ask me what lucid dreaming is like, look around. Look at your neighbor. Look at your chair. Look at the walls. That's what lucid dreaming is like. You're in a real place. It's not a washed out memory of a dream. It's like you could be in a room just like this. I just had to make that point. You'll see why. So it's like I've noticed the fact, this crazy fact of dreaming for the first time. When this happens, inevitably my heart starts to pound. I'm almost in shock. As I walk, and I'm always walking, I can hear my footsteps, I can feel air in my lungs. Sometimes I kneel down and feel the solidness of the ground, the roughness of the embedded stone. At first, as I walk around, I'm kind of uncoordinated. It's kind of hard to steer my movements. All around me, everything is bright and colorful. The landscape has a kind of organic vitality. It ripples as if it were breathing. There's always this moment when I'm overcome by wonder.
This might exclude.
It's so beautiful. You can't believe that this is a possibility of life on Earth. Fully sentient immersion in another world, this whole other state of being that is nothing like normal dreaming. As you touch the world, as you interact with it, you begin to realize there are a set of laws operating here that are every bit as pervasive as the laws of physics in waking. One of these I call the law of extrema. Whatever you focus on in a dream becomes more exaggerated. That's because there are no external sensory constraints in dreams. So when you look at a tree, all your memories and associations of trees get activated and they keep piling up one on top of the other. It's like looking backwards through time to all the trees you've ever known. These are real laws you could find for yourself. You just have to learn how to look. By the way, nobody writes about this. It's hilarious. It's all dream interpretation. You have to keep moving in a dream, otherwise things start to morph and come apart. I call this the law of narrative momentum. Except just as in Second Life, if you move somewhere too fast in a dream, you can actually arrive at places that haven't fully loaded up. It is so weird. It's like standing at the edge of creation. But by far the most profound rule is the law of self-fulfilling expectations. In dreams, even lucid dreams, the things you secretly expect to happen often do. If you expect hostility, you get it. But if you expect something kinder, the world accommodates. In this way, the dream begins to show you something real about yourself, about your automatic patterns and often unconscious expectations about the world. For me, the more banal or commonplace the surroundings, parks, schoolyard, old buildings, the deeper the miracle. You keep thinking, what is this place? And then you realize, this place is you. Is there a more astounding act of translation in all of human life? Somehow the raw matter of all your experiences and all your longings is transformed into an actual landscape you can walk around in. You want to show people. You want to bring them here, but you can't. They have to find their inner landscape for themselves. Let's pause. We'll let that spiritually uplifting yet psychologically acute sentiment just resonate for a bit. Perhaps wipe a tear from our eye. That's enough of that. Now it's time for something altogether more frivolous and tawdry. Because that's the other thing about lucid dreaming. It's criminally fun. Lucid dreaming is a forum for the indulgence of every gorgeous, filthy, fun-loving, hedonistic impulse you've known and has been known to all of mankind and humankind and femalekind. You can do in a lucid dream whatever you like. except get the thing to operate. I knew I was in a dream. You can practice karate, or interrogate dream characters, or have sex with that Victoria's Secret catalog model you've been eyeing for weeks. Remember how you loved to fly in your dreams when you were a kid? Well, lucid dreaming is a chance to be a kid again and become what every single kid wants to be. A goddamn superhero. Okay. Now, I personally think we should do that again. Does anybody mind if I just play that again? This actually never works for me, by the way. I cannot fly in my dreams. When I fly, I fall into buildings. I try to have conversations with characters and they ignore me. I try to have sex. I'm like, I'm gonna have sex. I'm gonna lose a dream. I'm gonna see if I can have sex. And then I strike out like crazy. I get beat up. Basically, what I'm here to tell you is that I've democratized the state for losers everywhere. So it doesn't matter how bad a lucid dreamer you are. You can't be worse than me. Now, something else to say about lucid dreaming, it doesn't last. As with all dreams, eventually it comes to an end, and even Spider-Man has to come back down and in to waking reality. We're back at the sensory gateway. If you think you've left the dream behind, by the way, as we move into waking, you are mistaken. The dream is always there. It runs like an underground creek beneath all our waking processes, shaping sensory input, hinting at our secret expectations about the world. Right now, at the edge of waking, the day's first pulse of alertness enters our resting bodies. We move from the sleep and dreaming side to the waking side. And a state of consciousness known as the hypnopompic, a mirror image of the hypnagogic, except this time as the brain revs into waking, instead of heading in, we're heading out. In the hypnopompic, sounds and sights from the real world and the dream world can overlap like animated Venn diagrams. It's a space of unusual hallucinations and dissociations. We often wake confused, and if we wake in a strange bed, it can take a while to reorient ourselves. Where am I? Holy shit. Like a motel. Wake up in a motel? Where am I? In fact, we still have our moment-by-moment dream brains on. Scientists have a name for this phenomenon. They call it sleep inertia. It's a kind of impairment. That means it's not a good time to operate and handle heavy machinery. But eventually, the brain shakes off that last bit of inertia, and the day begins in earnest. Consider the brain. It operates at all kinds of tempos in response to all kinds of situations. It makes you wonder, is there a state of consciousness in which the brain is the most efficient? There is. Think about those times when you're absorbed in some activity and yet feel perfectly in control. This state actually has a name, and that name is Bond. James Bond. A man who moves down a ski hill like water down a mountain. A paragon of practiced efficiency. When a challenge presents itself, James Bond is ready. That's because he lives in the zone. You are James Bond in the zone. Also called flow, it's a state cherished by artists and athletes, but available to anyone. Time itself can seem to slow down in the zone. So absorbed are you in the game, or the music, or the job. Thus, the occasion's obstacles are dispatched. The key to the zone is not getting self-conscious. You need to go through life. You need to keep the existential thinking to a minimum, just like 007. He goes through life as if backwards off a ski jump. Never ever sweating the cognitive stuff. And so the moment flows. In the zone, everything is a habit of turning out just right. And if you do it with a dash of style, it will always be beautiful. Cue the Union Jack parachute! But the brain also regularly disengages from the world. Even in the middle of the day, it turns inward. We call this
8 and 8 is
the daydream.
16 and 16 is 32. 32 and 32.
The daydream is the truant of waking consciousness. We daydream 10 to 20% of our waking lives, often in the early afternoon, in that drowsy period after lunch when we slump at our desks and drift into delicious private fantasy. Band called Metaform, very good band. In daydreaming, our thoughts are more freewheeling and uncensored. They move in strange directions, all these beguiling trails by turns crooked and scenic, spun like crop circles in the cornfields of our minds. By the way, I have no idea why I chose this footage. It's very weird. I guess I was daydreaming. Something about its airborne quality. In their looping imagery and preoccupations, daydreams often have a familiar shape. They're like hieroglyphs, single phrases in the larger language of our personality, carved into the neural field. Daydreams are a careful slide. Daydreams are a carefree slide towards interior immersion, the very beginning of a real dream. But it turns out, it turns out that dreams can impose themselves even more dramatically on the waking brain. In fact, they can take it over. It's called the trance. The trance is the black hole of the mind. It draws in focal attention and shears off peripheral awareness. If you've ever been so absorbed in a task that you lose all sense of the external world, then you've been in a kind of trance. The trance is like the deep zone. When it's combined with hypnosis, it's also a state of high suggestibility, and thus a reversal of agency. In the trance, there's evidence that our executive frontal lobe processes are inhibited. Although we may feel perfectly normal, we become overly sensitive to charisma. Look closely at the screen. At such times, the hypnotist can impose specific suggestions on his subjects. We may hear voices that aren't there, or see actual images plucked from the dream world and superimposed over waking reality. Watch closely, stare into the center. Allow yourself to surrender to the force of this visual charisma.
Religion is the only authority. Science is the only authority. Religion is the only authority. Science is the only authority.
You will all be my slaves! In a hypnotic trance, some of us behave like zombies. Or if you prefer, like Filipino inmates dancing en masse to Michael Jackson's Thriller. It's shocking, shocking how easily some of us surrender ourselves to the hypnotist. And who is the hypnotist? The hypnotist is the man. He's school, he's language, he's culture, he's ideology. The hypnotist is any authority that pulls in your compliance and pressures you in any way to adhere to a single norm or perspective. All of this is trance. Can you hear the hypnotist? He's laughing right now. Some philosophers have argued that all of waking is a trance, a consensus reality of permissible experience. Fortunately, as in lucid dreaming, with the correct training, we can learn. To wake up! Timing was off. Hold on a second. Now, the question is, what is it like to really be awake? Did it work, by the way? Snap my fingers, wake up. Are you awake? Are you sure you're awake? Pay attention. This next part is very important because something perfect is about to happen to that brain. Have you ever noticed what it's like to really be awake? I'm sure it's happened to you, those rare times when you look up from your life, and in the words of Annie Dillard, a great door opens on the present. The moment breathes. In this state of open, heightened alertness, nothing seems mundane. Everything is charged with significance. At these times, the brain produces a curious spindle of electrical activity over the sensory motor cortex. It's called the sensory motor rhythm, or for short, the SMR. Even if we don't recognize the acronym, we all recognize the state when we're in it. Watch. Listen. Alert, but not tense. Calm, but not spaced. The world's spatial resolution is boosted so that we can make out individual sensory strains more clearly. In this vast open space, both internal thoughts and external stimuli have a crisp, sharply defined quality to them. These are precious moments. This feeling of being in the world and not just passing through it is justly celebrated in many religious traditions. The Buddhists famously call it mindfulness, and Western scientists are beginning to realize it's a kind of awareness that can actually be learned. Thus, mindfulness moves from a state of consciousness to a permanent trait of consciousness. With more clarity and equanimity, we no longer respond to the world's challenges automatically. In this way, we become truly free and truly awake. Well, our head trip has come to an end. And now that I know you better, for I just completed a full circumference around your mind, now that I know you better, I have a question. who are you? Are you a body with animal needs like we met in the parasomnias? Or are you an outlet for a more refined style of physical action like we met in the zone? Or perhaps you're more emotional, buoyed by deep feeling tides as in the REM dream. But you have a more fundamental emotional capacity too, an oceanic source of bliss deep under the surface, your slow wave self. Of course, some of you may protest you are more the creative type, and you are right to do so. You have your elliptical hypnagogic associations, after all, and that protected space in the watch where you can float between worlds. Nor is this a nighttime privilege. In every daydream, you can, for a brief time, enter a more freewheeling and uncensored state. The trance and the hypnopompic both show us that dream imagery can make an appearance on both sides of the sensory gateway. Something to keep in mind next time you can't believe your eyes. But the trance also speaks to our deep capacity for surrender, how easily we adopt an imposed reality. It makes you look for the hypnotist in the room. Q. It's a destabilizing thought, so let me reassure you, I know you are capable of greater self-possession, for I've seen it. Even at night, you can exercise your agency in the lucid dream. There, you're no longer at the command or the whim of every automatic impulse, a true explorer in command of your internal fate. In waking, we call this mindfulness, or SMR for a more technical gloss. This is the domain of the truly liberated person, awake in the world. If you remember nothing else from this talk, remember this. Each of these states of mind privileges a different style of knowledge, a different way of knowing the world. This is why they matter. They vastly expand the territory of you. But I promised you 12 stops in our trip. By my count, we've visited only 11. There's one more. A state of consciousness upon which all the others rest, without any frame whatsoever to support it. It's called pure consciousness. And it's what happens when all the content of your mind, all your thoughts and dream images, sensations, emotions, memories, when all of these things settle, and all that remains is the void. Though exceedingly rare to experience, this substrate of the self is actually accessible to human investigation, most often as a product of extended meditative practice. The idea is that as you pay finer and finer attention to the sensory units of mind, you begin to notice the seams, and then the empty space between the seams, a kind of nothingness out of which all experience rises and falls, expanding and contracting like a huge, formless lung. What is this empty source that breathes experience? It's the ultimate question, posed in different ways by everyone from the Greeks to the Taoists to modern physicists. You can actually feel it if you try. That little thrill in your chest expanding and contracting. The microscopic undulations in your vision expanding, contracting. The gentle patterning of the music, expanding, contracting. It's happening right now. You're being breathed. I'm not sure who you are, but maybe you do. Maybe you can sense you're not a thing at all. Rather, you're an activity, expanding and contracting, the universe breathing through you. The language doesn't sound very scientific, but this is the insight people report. It points to a profoundly liberating stage of psychological development that, with practice, anyone can attain, though few realize is even there. It's the ultimate shift in perspective, one that takes you forever out of yourself and into the world, this world. Welcome home. Air guitar! Woo! Turn the music! So I thought, if you guys have any questions or anything like that, I'm happy to take some questions. Maybe you have no questions, or you're like, I don't know what it was that thing I just saw. It was really weird. But if you feel like asking questions, you're welcome to ask me anything, and I'll try to answer. I try to fly, but what happens is, this is always what happens. Usually I'm in an alley for some reason. That's why I had that alley scene. And I kind of float up a little bit, and then it's like I'm like some kind of weird crippled bird. I have to flap my hands, and I float up a tiny bit, then I kind of swoop back down again. I come up a little bit, I swoop back down, and every time I think I'm about to break out, I suddenly swoop down again. And then usually I just start doing backward somersaults, and then I'm completely out of control, and then I usually like hit a building or something. I mean, when I was young, I flew all the time. And then I think it's an interesting question, because when you're young, in a lot of ways, your consciousness is much more expansive. And again, it speaks to the thing about expectations. You don't know you can't fly, really, so you do. So this is the thing about dreams. It tells you about your own constraints. So if you can get into a habit of the wilder the number of things you can do in a dream, the more expansive, in a sense, the wider the contour around yourself. I mean, dreams represent the far outer limit of where you've been. So it's good to practice craziness for that reason, in waking and dreaming. That's my belief.
There's a communication in between the subconscious and conscious to tell, now you fly. Do it again.
Well, I don't think anyone really understands exactly the mechanisms. Expectations are, people talk about them as properties of the frontal lobe, emergent properties, but it gets to the mind-body question. But basically you have volition within it, but you have your own unconscious expectations that are kind of acting against you sometimes. So yeah, I guess you could put it in Freudian ways. It's like a battle between the superego and the ego and the id and all those levels. But you can bring them all into alignment, I mean, that's what spirituality is. That's what all these guys were talking about. That's what flow is. Flow is like flowing with all the different levels, in alignment. I mean, it seems to me. I might not be right, though. Maybe flow is something else. Actually, it's the zone. It's James Bond.
Yeah. What are your thoughts on dream interpretation, assigning specific meanings to specific symbols and colors and words?
Yeah, I think dream interpretation is amazing. I think it has to do, in my mind, I mean, I'm not an expert on it, but I think it seems to me that your symbol, you have a personal roster of symbols that come with your own history and your own experience, and that there are probably universal symbols too that come from just the fact that we're human beings and we have parents and we walk in a world and there's gravity and there's all these common universal experiences humans have, so that then, for that reason, there's probably universal tropes that appear in dreams. But as far as an hourglass representing time and well, actually, I guess it would. But as far as a strawberry representing a strawberry. Okay, wait a second. Where am I going with this? No, but you know what I mean. Like as far as a peacock representing fate and like an eagle representing, the fact that you're going to go blind in 8 years and a step representing, that you like Hershey chocolate chips, and everyone else does too because that's what steps mean. I mean, I'm into archetypes, I guess I need to learn more about it, but I'm suspicious.
Yeah. Tell us
Oh, well, that's a different subject. Well, we had a question up here.
Do you have any views on out-of-body experience? Because it doesn't seem to fit in that circle. They do exist.
It's really interesting. I do think they... I mean, there's two. I mean, my own take on most of these things is I try to be kind of neutral. Like, I feel like I'm more of a curator of ideas, so I love both the neurobiological and the spiritual and, like, the new age takes. I think they're all really interesting. And so there are neurobiological takes on the out-of-body experience that has to do with it's a lucid dream. People argue it's a lucid dream. I mean, I'm with you. I think it's more to it than that. But they say that it's a dissociation, it's the body maps and da-da-da-da. But then again, I have a friend, Charles Tart, who has done experiments, and he did this famous experiment. It was not famous to scientists, but to people in more esoteric communities. And there was a woman who had out-of-body experiences, and she talked about her out-of-body experiences and to him one time, and he was like, well, would you ever want to come in and do an experiment? And she said, okay. And so she came into the lab, and you may have heard this story, but she came into the laboratory, and so.
I have a question. Do you have a view on what one can learn about consciousness from the effect that experience-altering substances like magic mushrooms?
Yes, yeah. I think they're amazing tools for exploring consciousness. And I guess there's many reasons for that. I think they have to be done. It has to be done carefully. And the reason I think they're so important is that Stanislav Grof talks about psychedelics as being non-specific amplifiers. And what they do is, in a sense, they vastly expand the topography of your own mental processes. So things that, similar to meditation, but different. So things that formerly seemed very vague or obscure, like the moon, you look at the moon, you can just see a little bit of white and it seems okay. Then you look through a telescope and boom, all of a sudden you can see ridges and the dark bands and mountain ranges. And so they act in a similar way. They expand the topography of the mental experience so you can begin to make out, different dynamics. And then the way they interface with the perceptual system. I mean, they're wonderful laboratories for understanding the mind, just like a dream is. That said, they have to be taken very seriously because, they can also really derange the mind. I mean, I know a lot of psychonauts who have done a lot of psychedelics, and some of them have just lost their marbles, That's unlike a spiritual path. I mean, you can get it with a good shaman, but a spiritual path, you get a good spirit teacher, they teach you how to get to the source. They're there to kind of watch over you, every step of the way. You do psychedelics totally wasted on acid in like a freaking parking lot at a Grateful Dead concert when you're 17 years old, you're toast. It's like you'll be putting the marbles back together for the rest of your life. So that's my take on that.
Hello. Have you had any fatalities during your head trip? Have you died in a dream?
In a dream? Oh, many times. I once got shot in the face on the top of a building. Some guy had a gun. I was like, I'm in a dream. I walked up to him. I'm like, hey, this is a dream. I'm in a dream. You can't hurt me. And he just shot me in the head, and that was it. And I was dead. And I woke up, and I was like, that was the worst dream I ever had. Yeah.
Is there any reason why you have 12 stages? Could it be 11 or 13?
Oh, my God. It's so arbitrary that most of the book was spent trying to figure out the classification system. Like, they hadn't really been classified in this way, so it's totally arbitrary. There could be 500, there's three, and the fundamental, there's three fundamentals. There's slow wave sleep, there's dreaming, and there's waking. And then there's what Hindus call the fourth, which is pure consciousness. And that's like, that's the terrain, those four. The rest of these are kind of mixtures of them and transition zones between them. And you could, there's lots more. And in fact, even then, a lot of them blur together, like the zone and the trance are very, they overlap and daydream. I mean, that was where I spent a lot of time trying to figure out what all these, how they all related to each other and reading all the literature, and no one really talked about them in a kind of holistic way. So that was a challenge. But, and of course, also there's all the meditative states, which I just talk about pure consciousness and mindfulness, but there are, they're unlimited. They just go forever in every direction. It's so cool. Yeah.
Tell us about your childhood.
Well, I, no. Next question.
Why did you decide to explore all of this?
That's a good question. There's a bunch of answers, I guess. One answer is when I was 20, I broke my neck. So we talk about fatalities. I almost died, and I fell out of a tree and broke my neck in two places, and it really it changed the way I thought in terms of the example of it. It literally changed my processing style. I was much more linear before, and I don't know, and afterwards I was much more associative. And I don't know what the hell that was about, and I didn't see a neurologist at the time or anything. I was in traction and all this stuff happened. But I just knew that I couldn't do my work the same way, my studies. I had to come up with new techniques for arranging my notes and things. And I've heard there's a thing called shearing. When you have a traumatic fall, you got to really hit hard in the head. And the brain has gray matter and white matter, and there are different densities, and they can kind of shift. And so there's shearing that happens between the densities. So I wonder if something like that happened, but that I have no idea. No one's ever said. I've never had a doctor analyze my head. It's the one person I never went to. But I became really interested because of that, because my style of thinking really changed. I became really acutely aware of internal experience. I kept noticing it, thinking about it, wondering what the heck was going on. And the more I thought about it, the more interesting it became. And then I started, at school I studied literature. I was an English major. And I just always loved the books I loved the most were descriptions of internal experience, like the pattern, like parts of Annie Dillard books or David Foster Wallace or Saul Bellow or Nabokov or whoever it was I was reading. Whenever they describe anyone, well, like Ulysses is the famous example and Virginia Woolf, but whenever they describe their own experience from the inside, I was just fascinated. So I started to collect all those anecdotes and stories and quotes from that and thinking about it. Then I got interested in the biology of sleep for different reasons. I just thought it was so interesting that no one understood why we sleep, because sleep is a mystery. There's no consensus as to why we even sleep, which is mind-blowing. You spend 8 hours a night sleeping and no one knows for sure why that you do. So anyway, so I got interested in sleep, and as soon as I started investigating sleep, and more than on the science side, the neurobiology, of course I was confronted with this fact that there's these very different domains inside sleep, these very different experiences. And I remember trying to lucid dream when I was a kid. You know, I bought like the Omni. You guys remember Omni? It's a great magazine. It was like this kind of funky 70s science fiction speculative magazine. And then they had like lucid dreaming articles in it, and I would try to lucid dream, and like now, I wasn't very good at it. So all these things basically came together, and I realized I had this larger project I'd been working on, which is about trying to classify consciousness, and I said, well, I'm just gonna try to write a book about it. So that's what happened.
Did you ever have a dream in which you dreamt?
Yes.
How many levels?
Three or four.
And did you ever have a dream where you were injured and you woke up and the injury was on the body?
You mean like I had a dream and then my neck was hurting and I woke up and there was like, you know, something had chopped my neck or something?
Or maybe like even a mark, an injury transferred from the dream to the body.
Oh, no. Can that happen? Holy cow! He said that you can get an injury in a dream and you wake up and it manifests in life, in the body. That's crazy, but it might be true. Cool. I mean, if he's saying it, maybe it is true. I believe you. Yeah, exactly. You don't want to get too paranoid about it. You still need to get strike out in a dream with Victoria's Secret catalog models. We can never take that away from us. Anyone else before they kick me off the stage?
Do you have lucid dreams, or are you capable of having lucid dreams every night?
No, not at all. I think I've had 12 lucid dreams in my life.
Can people do that?
Oh yeah, some people can, every night. He could probably do it every night. I mean, no, seriously, like my friend Stephen LeBurge, who's done the most interesting thinking on this and from a scientific perspective, he's an amazing lucid dreamer. He lucid dreams every night if he wants. The thing is, learning to lucid dream is kind of a bummer because it really disrupts your sleep. You know, it's easiest to do it early in the morning, so you set an alarm in the early morning and then you wake up and you sort of set an intention and you kind of repeat to yourself, you know, is this a dream? This whole thing is about questioning. I discuss it in my book how to do it, but it's all about learning to question reality as a kind of habit, and that habit carries over into the dream. And so it's quite a bit of work to really get at it. I mean, although here's something very interesting. 91% of you will have a lucid dream tonight. Could be 85. But basically, it's a phenomenon. It's called there's another law that I talk about in the book, and it's called the law of beginner's luck. And for whatever reason, I mean, a lot of you have probably heard it already because you're all like consciousness new age people, so I'm sure you're down with it, but or maybe you're not all. Some of you are. And that's my people. Woo-hoo, I'm here. We're all here together. But basically, if you haven't heard of it before, because I've just spent all this time talking about it, I've now primed your brain in a way, your mind, which is a more interesting organ. And so there's a very good chance you'll have it tonight. And if you do, you have to send me an email and tell me, because I'm curious if it'll work. So my email is, I'll tell everybody my email. It's jeff@jeffwarren.org. So just send me an email and be like, it didn't work, you asshole. Or I got beat up by you.
Yeah.
Yeah, I've never met her in any of them in a dream, actually. I once had a dream I was trying to like approach the like, it was the MTV beach house. And it was like, it had all this barbed wire. I was like, oh my God, this is the MTV beach house. There's gonna be rock stars and like super hot models. And I never got in. I didn't get in. I got shot down by a guard, and then I ended up hanging out with like a bunny or something and like eating some grass and then waking up, you know. This is what always happens in your dreams. You have those ideas, you want to do something really cool, and you end up talking to like some 50-foot pile of silly putty.
Before your book project, did you have experiences where you just shared your dreams out loud, verbalized it? Was that a habitual?
I would bore my friends with my dreams occasionally, and I was always very entertained and interested in other people's dreams. But no, I didn't generally even think about them that much. I have a very vivid dream life because I'm a very light sleeper, and so if you're a light sleeper, light sleepers tend to have the most vivid dreams because you're closer to the surface of waking. Deep sleepers, you know, by the time they get up to make a report, it's gone, you know, because they have to rise up 15 phantoms. So I never really did, but one interesting thing is that since the book's come out, everybody tells me their dreams now, which I love, because it's like you get this window and these really personal take on people. I mean, dreams are very intimate and in ways people don't even realize. So when someone really tells you their dreams, and you can really get a sense, a beginning of a sense of you know, their interior life.
There is an experience I'd like to share, because, you know, before tonight, I didn't really label it as lucid dreaming. And because when I was 4 years old, I fell down a flight of stairs and I got, you know, hurt. I don't really recall the specific incident, it's just that I fell down and was hurt. So I was sort of told to stay away from that flight of stairs. And what I didn't realize was back then, when I went into the dream world, I consciously chose to say, hey, what it would look like if I actually flew down that stairs. So I basically, at four, I didn't know I did that, but I did. I posed myself the challenge of what would really happen. And I started to experiment with sort of effortlessly flying, like not physically touching the steps, down a set of stairs. And what eventually happened was, in real life, I learned to really move downstairs
with
effortless ease. And I used to, as a kid, it's, you know, you can wiggle your ears, can you stick out your tongue? So I would basically say, hey, can you glide down the flight of stairs? And I would basically challenge people. And the more fun I had, the more I realized, man, this really works. So that's a process I've just worked with all my life.
That's amazing.
If I wanted to get some stuff done, I would say, okay, tonight I'm getting this done.
And that's amazing.
So, that is huge. What you're talking is huge. It is probably the biggest insight. One of the biggest insights that can come out of, like, when you look at waking next to dreaming, you put the two together, is that there's this idea that somehow your dreams and even your imagination is somehow unreal. That is so untrue. Every action is real action in your brain. You know, a dreamed action, that's what I said about practice karate. If you go in a dream and just practice karate kicks, you will get better at karate in real life. It's exactly the same principle that pro athletes use when they do visualizations, which, by the way, are not nearly as, like, immersive as a real dream. So they'll, like, you know, Michael Jordan will just, like, think about, or Tiger Woods, about hitting, like, you know, his puck or whatever they freaking use in sports, you know, 50,000 times, you know, jing, here we go, hitting his baseball, you know, boxing. And anyway, they go through these rhythms, these visualizations, and they actually get better at it. So it means that, it really speaks to the gravity of the dream. That's why I say it's a rehearsal for an extended life. That's what dreams are. They literally are rehearsals for an expanded life. So you figured that out early without knowing it.
And I never labeled it that way, so I really appreciate what work really informed what it is that you're presenting tonight.
Yeah.
Thanks. I'm going to rest tonight. I'm super tired. Oh, I rest all the time. Yeah, I mean, everybody rests. Yeah, I'm quite lazy, actually, and unproductive a lot of the time. And I just sit around and be like, oh, man, cool, mind, and think about things about the mind. And there was one thing I was going to say, though. Oh, God, I don't know if we have time. This is the craziest thing that happened. It's kind of a long story. I don't know if I have time to get into it. But,
long story.
All right. Well, I'll just do really fast. So like four months ago, I got this Facebook message, this really cryptic Facebook message. And it said, and I get lots of weird, because in my book I get lots of weird emails and people saying all kinds of weird stuff. And this one was like, hi Jeff, I really like your book and I built an invention based on your book. Do you want to know more? And I was like, okay, tell me your invention. You know, here we go. And it turns out it's this totally sick, wicked, cool invention. And it's called the Dream Director. And it really is based on all this functionality I talk about in the book. And what it is it works on a very simple principle, and I'm sure it's happened to you. In fact, I talk about it in the tour. Like when the guy is laying there on the phone and on the TV, the phone on the plane, and then the phone in real life. When you're drifting there, maybe you're having a dream that bells are going. There's bells in your dream, and you wake up and your alarm is going off. And so the principle is called incorporation. And even though I talk about how you walk on both sides, you go from the waking side to the dreaming side, and sensory input is totally removed. It's actually not totally removed. Little bits of sensory input can get in, and in certain conditions, at certain times in REM, they can really get in. And if you know how to shape the sensory input, you can basically begin to tweak the dream narrative, because sensory input is just another association. So if you, for example, can put a sensory input in of your mother's voice, if your mother's voice came up at like, in a REM period from the outside and it wasn't too loud and it didn't have a droning constancy, which mom's voices sometimes do, it could make its way into the dream. And then, of course, it's triggering all these associations of your mom, so you might start dreaming of your mom. And that's what the Dream Director does. It's basically, it takes four kinds of sensory input. It has four arms like an octopus. One arm is a pillow, which you sleep with, and it's the speakers in the pillow, so the sound comes through. One arm is a little buzzer, so like a vibrator you can put under your root chakra or under your armpit or somewhere, and it vibrates in time to the whatever sound you've chosen. I'll get to the sound in a moment, because there's more to that. Then there's a smell thing, an aroma smell dreamer thing, which he takes different tarts, like say lavender. And there's lots of research, you wake people up, if you put lavender under their nose, because this, by the way, all speaks to a kind of secret history of research into scientific research into dreaming that it happened in the 19th century when everyone's forgotten about it. Because back then they couldn't look at the brain, so the only way they could study dreams was by provoking weird effects on the outside, like putting weird smells under people's noses and flashing lights and then waking them up and being like, what happened? That was 19th century science. That was a great dream. What happened? I was in a ballroom with a magnificent woman, and that's what would happen. It was 19th century. So anyway, this thing uses these different sensory modalities to kind of remix the dream. So you're like, basically, it turns you into kind of like a DJ of the mind, and you can set up sequences of stimuli, and you can figure out when they come up into the dream, and then you can create, and the most powerful one is the audio, the music. So you can create what we call dream tracks. Oh yeah, by the way, so the story was, I wrote the manual. He was like, do you want to know more? Then he was like, do you want to write the manual? I was like, sure. So I just finished writing it, and it's going to be in a PDF you can get online. It's like, ended up being like 20,000 words. I think it's practically another book, because it gets into the history of the research. But anyway, so you can make these things called dream songs, which are like whatever you want, and you then build associations with those songs. So it might be whale music. It might be jungle sounds. It might be sex sounds. It might be sound of your own voice, sound of your friends. There's unlimited combinations, sounds from city streets. Maybe you want to do a soundscape of Paris, and then another night do a soundscape of Madrid, And the idea being that you can't control your dream, of course, but you can begin to tweak it in ways that are really interesting, and that might be surprising to you. And so you can learn, again, a lot about your own unconscious associations, and it also helps you lucid dream and stuff, too. But anyway, that was enough about that. But that was pretty cool.
You're looking for volunteers now, right?
Yeah, I would like volunteers to practice it, because right now the thing's barely been used. He's used it. I've done it a few times. It totally messed up my sleep, by the way. Because I was trying to write the manual, so I didn't know how it worked, and I'm like trying to figure out how it worked, and oh, by the way, there's a piece of it called the erection switch, which ties around your dick. Because basically, when you enter REM, you get an erection. It's like clockwork. So that's how it tells for guys when you're in REM. So you're sitting, saying, the thing's tied around your dick. You fall asleep. You know, you get an erection, boom, and unclasps and signals the dream director to begin the show. So I was having dreams of being like dragged around by my penis behind a giant car. Like, so. Which is probably more information than you need to know. There's a timer. Basically, the women have a very similar mechanism, but the team of all male engineers was stumped as to how to access it. They couldn't find it. Yeah.
It surprises me, actually, because when you talked about that little thing that was a vibrator and they invented, I thought you were going to say something about that in that context.
Yeah.
May I just add
something about that, but I won't.
Very quickly, but I just add one thing to what you've said here. In my own research, one of the things I've done is to work with people who come to my matrix clinics for rehabilitation purposes. And in a number of those cases, what's happened is that someone will actually not have a functional use of a limb. So what I do is to have them go through initially visualization techniques of moving the limb. And what I've done is then to compare that to other people who come but don't exactly do that and do other sorts of things. And the people who actually think about moving the limb actually recover more quickly than the people who just come.
Right.
Similarly, you extend that in the context of the athletes, particularly elite athletes I train, which refers to what you were saying. And one of the other techniques that I use in that context is actually to introduce the daydream as a transitional point between the normal process of sport performance visualization and actual daydream, so that you move into a transitional dream state, actually going through the movement. And then that, in turn, we try, as it were, to encourage people to take the lucid dream and become very efficient with respect to creating those situations of winning, hitting the ball, you know, a basket in the hoop or whatever it is. And so that's some of the stuff, the new stuff that's happening, which relates very much to what you said.
Oh, very much. That's very smart. And using three states is great.
Three states.
Yeah, very cool. All right. Oh. Of which? Oh, you mean seeing into the future? Well, I've never had that experience unless deja vu, that's what deja vu is. So I can't speak from experience, but I hadn't done a lot of research into it, but after my book came out, a lot of people contacted me about that and I began to do some reading. And there is some pretty interesting literature and there's some really interesting experiments that have happened. Very good scientists have done experiments that seem to show there's a real effect there. So. I mean, again, it comes down to the mind at large versus mind stuck in the head. If you think mind stuck in the head, then you're going to think it's baloney. If you're into mind at large, then you're going to be like, yeah, of course it's true. So me, I prefer this to be neutral.
Thank you very much, Jeff.